Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this afternoon's session on the Hackers and Threats Track. The title is Securing the Pod Bay Doors, HAL, Cybersecurity Risks of IoT Automation. Our speakers are Stephen and Numaan. Stephen Hilt and Numaan Hook are both senior threat researchers at Trend Micro. Please welcome them.
Hey, everyone. I'm Stephen Hilt.
Make sure you read all those instructions, of course.
There you go.
Thank you. So again, I'm Numaan Haq, and this is Stephen Hilt. Welcome to our talk, Secure the Pod Bay Doors, HAL. Before I start with the talk, I just kind of wanted to tell you about our motivation for doing this project. It started as a sort of a hackathon. A couple of us got together at our director's house. He has a smart home. And we just started like playing around with it to see what we can do with it. And just seeing if we could create some vulnerabilities, if we could find some ways of hacking things. And it was just a really fun project, which I'm glad to say expanded into something bigger. And today we're here talking about this. So without much ado, let's get into a demo of what we did. So we programmed a smart alarm, and this is how it worked.
Alexa, Alarmanlage an.
Finally, HAL has opened the pod bay doors.
So we're going to go. We're going to go into a bit. Might have to increase the volume.
Hello?
So we're going to go into a bit more details about what we did with the smart alarm a little bit down the road. So let's start with some basics for this. So basically, what are IoT automation platforms? They are they're the brains which control all the devices in your house, and basically it allows you to create rules that you're going to use for connecting multiple devices. So previously, when we had home networks, we just connect different things to the internet and just hope they work. Now what's happening is that there is more and more devices, and some of these devices are interconnected with each other, and as you start growing the number of devices in your house and you want to make your life simpler, you start using automation rules and automation servers to create new applications. So you chain together multiple things to create many things, like we saw with the smart alarm, and we'll go into the details of it in a bit. And the other thing with IoT automation platforms is the ones that we've been seeing quite a bit, they're open source. And there's a large community of users who are adding more and more new devices to it. So I think the ones that we did, there's examples of monitoring, home monitoring systems, access control speakers, even things which control the sprinklers in your garden. You can connect these all to a home automation server and create rules which will streamline your life. And trust me, home automation is a good thing. So, when we were looking into home automation, we found that there is three types of IoT automation servers. One is the local automation server, so you basically install the server on a Raspberry Pi or an Arduino or on a Mac Mini, and you basically run it. Then there's the virtual automation servers, and this is what most people know. These are the Hey Google, the Alexas, and the Siris, right? You can connect multiple devices via Alexa, create rules, and then you can have things going. For example, in my home, when I say good night, Google Home turns off all the lights except one, and then plays some very strange music, which is supposed to put me to bed. And finally, there's the cloud-based automation servers. And the most popular ones is IFTTT. And basically, what you do is you push all your automation rules into a cloud-based platform, and you can control your devices as well as run pre-built applications that they have. They have a picture from their website which says, say, open the garage door when your BMW enters the driveway, which is good, right? You own a BMW. So yeah, those are the cloud-based automation servers, and these are kind of like a general overview of the three types of servers that we saw. So when we were doing this, we were trying to figure out like how do we define this thing? So we came up with this term called complex IoT environments, and we had a tough time trying to figure out exactly what a complex IoT environment is. So let's do a quick show of hands. How many people have 10 or more connected devices in your home? A very large portion. Okay, perfect. Now, another show of hands going like, how many of you have your 10 or more connected devices connected together to create an application? Very few. Okay, so this generally shows the trend that this is not like mainstream yet, but it is going towards mainstream very quickly. So after a lot of debating, we came up with a definition. So I'm gonna read this definition out just to make sure it's correct. So we defined a complex IoT environment as a minimum of 10 IoT devices which were integrated into an environment using an IoT automation platform that functionally chains the devices together to create smart applications. So that was a load of words that I said. So basically what it means is that if you have a lot of devices in your home, then you can start connecting them together to create an application like the smart alarm that we showed. That's essentially a complex IoT environment. And we'll get down to the basics of that in a bit. But first.
So one of the first things we set out to do is trying to define what kind of homes or buildings are in use. And for me, I was more of this first type, which is a bolt-on. We define the bolt-ons as things like when you go into, say, Costco or Sam's and you look there and they have the Wemos on sale, you buy those, and the next time the TP-Links are on sale, so you buy those, and you just kind of keep bolting things together, and now we have a smart home or a complex IoT environment where we have started to automate all these things together. The reason why now you need the automation platform, as Numaan mentioned earlier, is because the TP-Link app won't control the Wemo. So now you have something that, a platform in which you need to tie all these things together to make more of a homogeneous unit. The other type of home that we use is the purpose-built. This home is built from the ground up to be smart. In a lot of cases, we're not building a home right now. We bought a home that was already built. But in the case that if you're building a home right now, a lot of people are actually starting to look at integrating the stuff when they're building it. So for an example, our director over in Germany, which we'll talk about in a minute, he built his house from the ground up and built it to be smart. So instead of having light switches, he uses automation protocols, so the light goes directly to a controller. And then he uses a home automation protocol to control the controller. And then that turns on the light. So from the ground up, it was less wiring. He could focus where it was going and do a little bit better things and try to be smarter about how the house is laid out to be more efficient.
Alexa, Alarmanlage an.
The clicker uses that one over there.
Oh, okay, I see. Sorry, wrong one. Never mind.
The bolt-on, so what this came out of, I was kind of doing some home automation. Our director was doing home automation. Numaan was starting to do some home automation. Other coworkers of ours on our team were doing some home automation. And so what we decided to do was try to replicate some of what everyone was trying to do in two different types of methods. So when we refer to the bolt-on smart home, it was in the US. The purpose-built one was in Germany. And so this is just kind of some of the systems that we were using, such as smart plugs, thermostats, security cameras, voice-controlled devices, speakers. In this case, we were using a Unify access point for doing presence detection, so we could trigger rules and write rules based off of what's on the network or around the network. And as Numaan mentioned earlier, we ran things off Raspberry Pis, sometimes off of VMs and other things as well. Plus a Hue, Philips Hue system that runs Zigbee. Okay, thanks. So here's kind of a, in the US lab, we decided we'd use for the home automation server, we would use Home Assistant. It's one of the popular ones. It's very user-friendly to write rules. You literally over here write a rule. This is a rule to test to turn a Wemo on at 6:30 in the morning. And it, here it says, at 6:30, turn on the Wemo. So every day at 6:30, this will turn on with this rule. That's very user-friendly and user-driven. Over here, you can still get to the configuration files. They use YAML. And you can edit that file to do more granular, such as conditions that I want this to happen on Monday through Friday only. So Saturday and Sunday, let's not turn it on at 6:30. And so you can add conditions that you actually can't do in the normal web GUI. In Germany, we used kind of the same thing. We had Raspberry Pis that ran over there. We used a server called FIM. If you read German and understand German, it's really great. Otherwise, you're doing Google Translate on all the documents because it's all in German. HA Bridge, I don't know if anyone familiar with what HA Bridge is. So HA Bridge is really neat. Open source tool that you can run, and it emulates a Philips Hue bridge, but then it speaks to a bunch of other different devices. So Alexa supports Philips Hue, so you tell Alexa to do something. You can point it into the HA bridge, and it be not a bulb on the other side and do another action. It's a kind of a middleman in between. So we played with that there. We had network switches, patch panels, NAS. Over here, you'll notice InOcean. So this is where the home automation controllers are. They were InOcean. Is anybody familiar with InOcean? A couple people. So InOcean is a very lightweight radio protocol that the signal itself is generated by the press of the button. So that it generates enough electricity to send out the signal just based off of the energy of the press. Echo dots, same thing, speakers, you'll see a lot of commonalities, but the only big difference here is the inclusion of more purpose-built home automation protocols. This is kind of a picture of what we had. On the left, those are the InOcean controllers. Patch panels running to things, the NAS and stuff like that. So this is what we were dealing with within the German lab.
So as Stephen mentioned, FEM is mostly used in Germany. And if you read German, it's great. You understand it. Unfortunately, we don't read German very well. So most of the time, we were just struggling to try and figure out what was happening. The way you program rules into FEM, is you write it in a Perl-like language. And notice when I say Perl-like, because it gave me enough headaches. So here's an example of two rules that we wrote. So rule number one basically says when you open the balcony door and the lights will turn on for 10 minutes if the light outside, the lumen count is less than 500. And the lumen count is actually calculated from the front doorbell camera. It's got a lumen counter, so if it's less than 500, and you open the door, and it's evening time, then the lights turn on for 10 minutes. The second rule, it makes all sense, right? Like, just reading all of that. especially when it says, Außenlicht West. Okay, that's the west door, the west light. The second rule is an example of, this is an application our boss wanted. Basically, he said he put an InOcean switch beside his door. So he wants us to press it three times. And if any of the door contact switches in his house are open, I think there's about 7 doors, then it sends him a message, an SMS, saying that that particular door is open or closed. And before he leaves the house, he should go and close that door. So it's a very simple thing. It's basically taking door contact switches, it's taking a system which sends out an SMS to his phone, it takes an NOcean switch and puts them all together and creates an application that he uses every day. So basically that what I just described is an example of what we call a smart application, where you use automation rules, you use devices that are existing in the house, and they're all connected somehow to the cloud or not to the cloud. And we'll talk about cloud services a little bit later on. And together you create an application. In this case, pressing a button three times tells you which door is open or which door is closed. So moving on, I'm gonna get back to that smart alarm that we saw, and we're gonna dig down into some of the details. And just to refresh your memory, and especially for the people who just came in, I'm gonna play it again.
Alexa, Alarmanlage an.
So as you can see, Steven was inside the house, somehow a burglar.
Well, we broke the contact switch. There's also an ocean motion sensors inside the house, so it triggered on those as well. When we designed this alarm system, it was truly to be like an alarm system with motion sensors, contact switches, and then use the devices that are in the house already to make the alarm. So the idea here is all the lights in the house had turned on,
yeah.
All the blinds roll up, and all the speakers in the house are playing an alarm sound.
Yes, he's got about 3 Sonos speakers, and we put in a MPEG file in there, which it just continuously kept on playing. If you look at some of the components for that, so the smart alarm systems, first of all, the blinds. I know we don't have these in North America, but they're pretty common in Europe. The blinds are the outside. They come and go down. So the blinds have NOcean contact switches, or NOcean switches, and you can use that to raise the blinds or close the blinds. The second one that we used in this application was the contact sensors. So if you open the door, or I think we also included a couple of the windows, the contact switch was opened after the alarm was turned on, then obviously an alarm would be triggered. Sonos is used for playing the alarm sound, and we had to choose, there are 2 big dogs in the house, and we had to choose an alarm which didn't startle them too much, but that's a different topic. Alexa was used in this case. Our boss wanted to just say, Alexa, turn the alarm system on before leaving the house. So obviously Alexa was the switch which was used to trigger the alarm system on or off.
And as I mentioned before, this is one of those cases where we use the HA bridge as the light bulb that it was turning on, which actually it was actually a register value inside of FIM that it was changing then to make sure to enable the alarm system within the home automation system. So that's where HA bridge was used in this case.
The Hue bulbs, so here's his idea. If it's at night and somebody broke into my house, I want everybody from outside to see who was breaking into the house, which is why we programmed all the lights in the house to turn on as well as the blinds to come up. So the thief would be, or the burglar would be nice, well lit. And at the end of it, anytime the alarm system would trigger, it would send an SMS to our director, his wife, and it could also be programmed to send it to like the police station or something like that, right? So this is where we come in. We've described the smart application and the fun begins. Mr. Hilt?
So when we build the rules for an alarm, it's not as simple as alarm, just make it. We had to identify everything that we wanted to monitor, every output we wanted, an action we wanted to do because of that. So this is where we came up with this idea that complexity is the new enemy and attacks against the logic itself is going to be the latest threat vector. And to test this, we kind of went through some scenarios that we actually tested whether what would happen if we were an unsuspecting person and our systems got exposed or compromised in any way. So what we did as one of the first things, I don't know if anyone was familiar with my Sonos research from 2015. So I kind of realized that a lot of these devices have unauthenticated APIs. But in this case, that's if I had direct access to the speaker. Now let's see if we can do almost the same thing that we did then with the home automation systems. So the idea here is the attacker gets to the IoT speaker, to make the voice assistant do something in the house. We work on the forward-looking threat research team, and this is within this is in Home Assistant, and there's a text-to-speech option just right here when you click on the speaker itself, and you can type whatever you want in there. It will then use Google or any other text-to-speech. There's several different ones you can configure within Home Assistant, and it will make the speaker say that. So the idea here is let's try this again, but with our home automation smart alarm that we just made.
Alexa, Alarmanlage an.
And then she said okay, it was very faint, but that's why we'll show you there.
Alexa,
did change to on.
Alarmanlage aus.
And then with the Sonos speaker, we said turn it off. And then Alexa said okay. So now the alarm system's off. I didn't actually need to be in the house to do this if the system had been exposed in a way that I could remotely get to it. So now the alarm system's off and everything we just showed you about the blinds rolling up and the lights turning on and sending text messages, it's done. And it was just because all of these systems tend to have this text-to-speech that you can go to a speaker and do a text-to-speech. In a lot of cases, you can also say the text-to-speech isn't really good or you're having issues. You can also make it record some audio and point at all these speakers mostly to a MP3 and say, play that MP3, and it'll play. And it can be any MP3 you want. So then we also wanted to test a little bit about if there's a way we could spy on the users. So a lot of these have the ability to do notifications through SMS, through Slack, Discord, a bunch of other systems. More and more are being developed and added on as we speak. So we went with Slack because it's popular here for this one. And so what we're seeing is this is the logbook within Home Assistant. And so you can tell every time something turns on, turns off, and it keeps a record of this. But those are events that you can do action upon as well. So here we have an example about a motion in a camera that we called the garage camera. Take a picture of it. So take a snapshot of that camera when there's motion on, so the motion sensor. Take a snapshot and then send it to Slack. That's right there, service, notify, TM Labs, so Trend Micro Labs Slack. And what that does is if there is motion, it takes that picture and then uploads it. So this isn't the garage, but this is another one we did where it's on the back porch. So somebody moved, and this is an attacker's Slack. We move the camera, there's motion on the camera, take a picture, and this is it taking the picture and uploading it. So you can see multiple times people moving here in the backyard.
And this basically means that somebody can monitor whether you're at home or not, or whoever's at home, just using notifications put into several thousand lines of code, and you wouldn't know about it, you wouldn't spot it easily.
Yeah, at last count, this version, I think we're around 1,500 lines of code for automation. In Germany, it's roughly around 1,700 lines of code. If somebody got into it and altered it, and everything was working fine, the only difference was you were sending a picture or presence detection notifications externally. These are things that right now, for the most part, would go unnoticed because there is really no system to do integrity checks or notifications of change that are unauthorized to these config files. So, I mean, is anyone here run home automation systems that, you know, check the rules constantly to make sure they haven't been altered?
Any show of hands?
Oh.
No?
One then? Nope, that wasn't even one in the back. So, yeah, this is a problem that we're seeing, these things are just going to get more and more complex.
Yeah.
Every day I think of something fun that would be new to do, something else to change, something else to automate, something else to do things. So I have one rule in my house where based off of the weather, it'll turn on lights if it's cloudy, because you know certain rooms in your house will get dark, so you can turn those on at a lower, and you know you don't have to go around and flip the switches. That just automatically does it, and then if it becomes you know sunny again, just go ahead and turn them off. And the more you think about it, the more you can automate these things, and it really helps me with my kids who leave their lights on all the time to go ahead and turn them off when they're not in the room or things like that. But then we also decided we wanted to try about smart locks. They're up and coming. A lot of people are using them. There's been lots of back and forth debates on whether they're secure or not. We didn't really ever look at the security of these devices. We, again, were focusing on logic and how to attack logic and use the logic against the owners. So this is an August lock. I like it, pretty neat. It replaces the thumb latch on the door, so from the outside it's still a lock, and it just solely only replaces the thumb latch. But once you integrate it within Home Assistant, you have the ability to just click that button and it unlocks. And then just to show you, click lock, it locks again. So when I started doing this, it really had me think. And I was thinking, how do we attack this? And I had some pretty good ideas. Here's one, just smart lock is just how do we unlock the doors? The person's home, you unlock the door, so if somebody shows up, I did a test where if my phone joined the wireless network, unlock the door. That means I just came home. And you can also set it to only unlock it for like a minute and then relock it. So if I didn't come through that door, it's auto-locked behind me. But what if I'm away? Can the attacker then, you know, add a rule to be, instead of my phone, put his phone in there? And then be on the wireless or in proximity. Some of these systems, you can do Bluetooth for presence detection. And then that same rule would just unlock the door because it thought I was home. So this is where we are getting to some of those problems where the more we think about it, the more we automate it, we may be introducing some issues. But then one day I was sitting there and I was thinking, wait, I just wrote a rule that said if there's motion, send a picture. So can I do, if there's a motion, unlock the door? So this is what I wrote. It didn't play. Hang on a second, sorry about that.
Yeah, this is playing.
It's playing now?
Yep. Okay. I'll switch in a bit.
Maybe? Yeah, there it is. So that was the rule, it more or less just said what I described. On motion, on camera, unlock the door. So here comes our attacker. And the door unlocked. And in comes the attacker. And he's really nice. He locks the door behind him. So it's super nice. So that. We really started looking at that going, the more we do and the more things we try to automate, there's these little nuances we really need to be aware of. So when we're designing and building our smart homes, you need to make sure that this never happens. So you can, one, make sure no one can get access to these systems to do it, but you also probably should, in worst case scenario, plan if somebody has access to these systems, make sure that they still can't do this. So those are some ideas we've been kicking around with, and you know we wrote our paper and we have some recommendations inside the paper, and we'll get to those in a little bit. But for now, let's go ahead and start. We're going to start looking at some of the systems that we actually did find exposed. So we're going to look at some of the sensitive information we found. So these are systems we found online unauthenticated. In Home Assistant, they put a latitude and longitude that helps with the calculation of the sun, so you can do rules based off of sunset. So where you are, and that's why there's also the elevation.
And if you use the latitude and longitude, you put it into Google Earth or Street View, it will show you exactly where the house is. It's a very, very convenient tool.
Yeah, in my case, for my house, I made it like three houses down. So it's at the same, roughly the same sunset, but it's their house that gets broken into. And that's also the time zone to also confirm it. So where the time zone is configured based on the time that's running on the system. We didn't really mess that password because that's a default password for that D-Link. We kind of wanted to show that. So this is somebody who's doing a switch. It's a D-Link. The username and passwords are there. So they can log in and do presence detection within that. Now, if this system, and I have its remote IP, has that web interface enabled on the outside, this is where I can start figuring out what the username and password are, or that's what I know, but for the Wi-Fi. And then I can add my MAC address to the authorized, the known people and write rules based on that. And now I show up, I'm on their wireless, I unlock their door. There's Plex and other systems that you can see how they're configured, what the keys are, that's the API key to communicate to. Here is that rule we were talking about earlier, slightly modified and made more advanced. So this is one of those ones, when you're looking at these rules and they work, and you're happy they work, you don't really ever come back and visit them. But what if, in this case, we changed, we used Super Hacker Leet Speak and changed a E to a 3 and made a new variable that matched that so it would compile and run. But that's all we did was change that, so it now sets a value that's never actually checked to make sure all the doors and windows are closed. So this is going to be a quick test of that where we run through this check. So that's the rule, as we just described. This is it working in working as planned, so Numaan just pushed the button, there's the text message on the phone. So then we change it as an attacker, but then say we know there's a door or window that's open because we're in proximity to the house and we can see that it's open, but we know that this check happens. Yep. So what we do is, so the door is left open, we've changed the rule for the door that's being left open, he's getting ready to leave, does the check, three button pushes, text message, it says all doors are closed. It's obviously open. So that was a case where the logic you thought was right has been changed and altered to being logic that the attacker has made so that he can now just walk in that door.
One of the other things which people don't really understand is when they have a misconception over here. They think that when you're running home automation at home, all the data and everything that happens is happening locally, but that's incorrect. Now, let's think of, like, say you're sending a command to Alexa to turn off the light. Your light is connected to, say, a smart plug. The way it happens is that when you're telling Alexa to turn it on, Alexa is sending that command, is recording the command, sending it to the cloud, to Amazon. It's analyzing what it's saying. Then it's talking to the cloud provider for the smart plug, which then sends the signal down to the smart plug itself to turn it off. So you have, like, you're never really disconnected. You are not offline. All your devices are online, and all your data is stored, like, locally, right? So if I couldn't, like, take out the logic inside your house, but I managed to DDoS the cloud service provider, I would still be able to take out your house without doing any logic changes because you're never really ever disconnected. And that's one of the things people have to be, we found that, like, at first I thought that was really surprising, but then I realized that that's pretty much how it's working because I'm telling Alexa or Google, I'm giving them access to the API for my plugs or for my other devices.
So anyone in here a fan of software-defined radios, likes to play with them and dabble in software-defined radios? Okay. Just a couple. So do a quick demo. This is InOcean, if anyone knows about it. It's a wireless protocol, as I mentioned. It has known security issues. They have fixes for that. So this is a test in its default configuration, with which is no security. You can add security to it. It uses AES 128 with a rolling code. So there is the ability to secure this. But the attack footprint, you have to mitigate those, and you have to put firmware updates on all the devices to do it. But so here we're testing an unsecured version of InOcean with a replay attack. So what we did was we were there. This is Universal Radio Hacker, or URH. Saw the signal, and it's at 868.3 megahertz.
Yep.
And we saw it, so now we're going to try to capture it. There's the signal itself. There's two because there's a repeater in the house, so it actually just repeats it to make it go further. So what we'll do is we'll isolate that first one, knowing that there's a repeater. You could replay them both. It wouldn't affect anything. We're just trying to be nice here. So what you do then is you crop it to the selection. That's the actual packet itself over the wireless. We play it once. And this is one of our colleagues, Reiner, hitting the button saying replay it in the garage door. In this case, the InOcean switch is connected to the garage door, so when it powers on, it runs the motor, stops the motor, or runs the motor in reverse.
And there was a very expensive BMW bike in there.
Yeah. So now we stole his bike, just because we captured his packet of him opening the garage door. So now the interesting thing that happened here, and we don't have this on video when we were over there filming all these demos, is during this was the success. I actually managed to break his entire house. and this is a good lesson learned about security of home automation is sometimes we might accidentally over-automate things or use too many smart protocols. So what accidentally happened was, turned out my radio, I started looking at it afterwards as we were running around the house and none of the lights would turn on. Anywhere in the house, he'd run upstairs. Nope, nothing's working up here. Ran down to the basement. Nothing's working down here. Was about ready to reboot controllers. It didn't bring anything back. And
he
so
was
then
getting very angry.
He was getting very angry at us because we broke his house. Like, nothing's working. I was like, I've been doing this all day. What's going on? And then I looked at my radio, and I had this ginormous DC spike that was oversaturating the bandwidth because it's a very small bandwidth. And I was sitting right next to one of the repeaters. And so I just dosed his house by replaying a packet, and then it gets stuck. So all we did was I was just sending energy, and it was just jamming every InOcean device in his house.
Which happened to be every light switch and every other switch in the house. So he was panicking, going like, what should I tell my wife?
Yeah.
And the reason you don't see video is I decided that this was a good time to go to the bathroom and stay there.
Yeah, so it was an interesting finding that made us really realize that sometimes we can put too much in. You know, in the bolt-on option, I can still flip the switches. Yeah. Even if it is Philips Hue or, you know, whatever else, I can still make the light turn on and turn off with electricity. Here, you have to go down there and actually start unplugging things from the controllers to make them turn off or on. So we had that issue, which we found pretty interesting and didn't actually make it into the paper because we were already done with the paper, but very interesting finding nonetheless.
So we talked a lot about hacking into the systems, changing stuff. So the big question is, how would an attacker get into the system? Or where would they find it? And the question is, like, the solution is really easy. There's two ways we did this. We used Shodan, which is a search engine for Internet of Things. We went in there, typed in the name, and it spat out all the results for us. The other thing, which I kind of forgot to put over here, is if you knew the title of the web page that you're looking for and you put it into Google, Google would also give us a handy list of all the servers out there in the world for that particular device that was just sitting open out there. So the thing that came, like, what you can draw out of listening to Stephen describe all these attacks is that if an attacker has access to your logic layer, then it's basically game over. There's really not much you can do, and there's a lot of stuff that he can do. So to just do a very quick numbers is, we looked at a couple of them. We didn't use all of them. domotize is, I think, very popular in Europe, particularly in France. Home assistant is the one Stephen did. And FEM, which is mostly used in Germany, is way down over there. There's a 34 exposed. Domotizes 15,000. Home assistant is 6,000 plus. So these things are actually on the internet. They're sitting there. They're open. Here's some examples. This is FEM. This is somebody's FEM server in Germany. We just typed in the address, and his entire configuration file and everything just came up online. We didn't mess anything, I promise you. We're good people, good hackers. But we put in his latitude and longitude, and we found out where his house was. It was a nice house. It wasn't very far away from where we were. Another example is, this is Home Assistant. This is the one Stephen used in his house. We again found another person. They obviously love listening to Neil Diamond. And we could look at the history of which lights they turn on and turned off. We got the names of their kids because it was right there. We obviously blurred it all out. So all sorts of things are just sitting there exposed online. And now we get to the really cool bits of it. So one of the, we didn't play with Node-RED, but I think this is my favorite one. So what Node-RED is, it's basically a flow-based dev kit where you wire the hardware together, right? In this case, and the other thing with Node-RED is, Node-RED is ready for the cloud. So you can deploy it to Azure, you can deploy it to IBM Cloud, you can deploy it to AWS. And Node-RED can be used for, like, in this case, we're controlling the Wemo lights in your house. Or,
now this one I found really interesting. This one is a parking garage.
Yes.
And the automation of the parking garage, you know, checking for car statistics, time charts, car statuses, histories, things like that. So Node-RED, for people in industrial control systems background, does this make sense? This is just a logic flow diagram of how everything is going to be communicating to each other. It's kind of complicated for a home, just a general home person, unless they have that leaning to being wanting to do that anyway. But the interesting thing is, and this is something, our labs were homes, but the same stuff is being used in corporations and building automations,
yes.
Garages.
Industrial settings.
Industrial settings. We saw movie theaters. And this was just by looking at it. At first, we were like, wow, somebody's done a lot. And then you start looking at the names. And then start looking here and start looking there. And you're like, well, this is a parking garage. And they're doing, you know, some of those ones where they have the sensors in the telling you how many empty spots are on that floor. That's what this is to help automate some of that, to do the checking, to update the stuff, its statuses, and then there's all that information. So one of the big takeaways I want you guys to walk away with is, yeah, we were just talking about home, but this isn't home. More and more of these things are being deployed for business settings. I know from 2 years ago, Numaan went this year, and he can speak more to it, but when you go to CES and you're walking around, even they're adding Google Assistant, Amazon Alexa to every product.
Including your smart cooker.
And that includes
Instant Pot.
And that includes business devices that they're trying to help get those voice assistants into the businesses.
So I swear, this is the last slide. So I wanted to give our top three takeaways from this research. So the main thing is that IoT automation is it's a good thing. Because right after I did the research, I went and bought an extra like 6 or 7 smart plugs and plugged them all over the house. So it's a good thing. But you also have to be mindful of the fact that when you add IoT automation will help you streamline your life, but you're also adding a lot of complexity to your home, to your life, and to your building and everything like that. So you also have to be mindful of that, is that as you're adding more and more stuff, the attack surface or the attack vectors that can affect your home or your building is also steadily increasing. And finally, I like this thing. It says that today's society is adopting connected technologies at a faster rate than we can actually secure them. And unfortunately for us, Like, there is no like one solution I can tell you which you deploy over then it will secure everything. Because let's be honest, how to secure a baby monitor is not the same as how to secure your garage door. Right? Maybe it is, maybe it's not. But they'll have different parameters that you need to take into consideration. So that's kind of our top three, is that complexity is going to increase as you add more and more stuff to the logic layer. And the logic layer is going to be the next attack vector that the threat actors are going to use. So that kind of concludes us. We are open for questions.
Bay door, Hal.
Okay. Yes.
Sorry, I can't do that, Dave.
I don't know if his name is Hallen. So, interesting presentation. Makes me want to keep my hand down when you get all the way down to who has one IoT device installed in their home. Not me. But realizing that's never going to happen. Because the allure is there, right? This cool stuff you can do with it. So, you talk about complexity. And you talked about user interface, but I think that, in my opinion, the conclusion you missed drawing is it's not complexity that is the enemy. It's the complexity of the user interface. It's the lack of feedback in the user interface that tells the user the true current state of the system, right? Wouldn't you say it's the user interface its complexity is the problem, not in a... Because you have to introduce complexity into the system in order to be able to achieve the end you want to achieve. Otherwise, we'd just leave light switches in there and be simple. Or we wouldn't put any switches in and we'd just have one big switch in the garage and we'd turn that on and the house would light up.
So the user interface is part of it. That's why we wanted to show a little bit of the graphical centric versus the configuration based. And there's ways of getting information, but you also have to trust that that's the current state. Because I can go in there and just write the state to be something else. And until the state changes on a polling cycle, it'll always be in the false state. And you do that actually for testing purposes. You'll go in there and say, I want to make sure, enable that light on. But I don't really want it on. I just go in there and make the state on. And until the next polling cycle of that, the hue, the light will be on according to the home automation system.
It's a
complexity issue, but it's also just in general that it's the systems are becoming more and more complex, and the way we're approaching it may need to change a little bit.
I have another thing to add to that is, okay, say we create like the best interface on earth, right? Now grandma is programming her house. And grandma is not exactly the top-notch programmer out there. Grandma wants to put in these rules over there. And grandma, once she's done this, is not going to check if somebody's updated her configuration files or not. So even if you do have, so this is kind of the reason for the research, is we wanted to open up the discussion. I don't have a solution for you saying, like, this will solve it all. But it's one of the things, like, security researchers, people who are developing this, people who are developing the products itself have to take into account that complexity will be introduced, whether through the rules, whether through the devices, whether the number of devices, whether through an interface, or whether through the user. So
that kind of leads to my second question.
Sure.
Which is, in this, you listed maybe 12 home automation systems and servers. How prevalent is access control, and how easy is it to use? How can I ensure that I'm the user who alters the system?
So since we started this project a year and a half ago, some of them you had to configure passwords, such as Home Assistant used to come out of the box, no password, just you were able to go to it. Now if you install it, it forces a password. So we're getting there, and we're getting to places where the authentication is becoming more and more prevalent and on by default.
Yep. But for example, with FEM, it was actually quite a struggle to put in a password. It supports it, but it's easier to automate something than put in a password. Yeah.
In Home Assistant, when you used to put a password, it was a clear text password in the config file. But now, it's a salted hashed password in a hidden config file.
Yeah.
So we're getting there.
Yeah.
that they're learning and everyone's growing, and we just need to be ahead of it and help, because in 5 years, everyone in this room will probably raise their hands when we ask, are you doing home automation?
Thank you.
Yep.
I think you guys stumbled onto something I had always wondered, right? So in the good old days when you were wiring a house for security, you'd be running wires back to a panel, and it would be tripped, whether, you know, magnetic switch, but it would be a switch. Mm-hmm. Today we're doing wireless. So what happens when you flood a house with RF?
That signal won't, depending on the protocol.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And we
did.
Need to be more robust in our protocols and have anti-jamming embedded in the protocols themselves within the standards that they're using. That we need to have the ability to do that.
I think we've run out of time, but we can take these questions offline.
Yeah.
After.
Thank you both.
Yeah, we're out of time. We'll catch you out.
We'll catch you on, like, to be tested. Thank you.
Thank you.